say thank you. I see a couple of new faces that weren't here yesterday. So for anyone who didn't catch it, I am Kyle Goings. I teach music theory and composition here at University of Texas at Tyler. We are so happy to be hosting the 2019 College Music Society South Central Regional Chapter Conference. That's a lot of words. And so hello and thank you to all of our colleagues from across the region and across the country who are here joining us today. Before we introduce our keynote speaker, I'd just like to take a moment, now that we've got a pretty big crowd, to say thank you once again to all the people involved in putting this conference together. Some people working a lot behind the scenes, in particular Ms. Donna Abbey, our administrative assistant for the department. and her small legion of official student workers and also unofficial student workers who stepped up to help us. Thanks, Celeste. Who's been stepped up to help us over the last couple of years. Thank you. Our keynote speaker for today is Mr. Ryan Anthony. He is the principal trumpet for the Dallas Symphony Orchestra and also the president and founder of the Ryan Anthony Foundation. He's here to talk to us today about the power of passion as it relates to music. So please welcome him.
Thank you. start with that was not quite so serious. If you're in meetings all day for these few days, I was doing all right until I saw Michael sitting up there. And I figured, why am I trying to play jazz when he's out there? But this is really an honor and a pleasure. I'm so glad to be here today. Can you hear me? Is this working? Okay, all right, good. You know, I get a chance to speak and play often, but there's something about today that kind of I found difficult trying to put together. And I think why, and I'm gonna quote Kyle on this, the very first email. Yeah, you had asked me to come here today because of the unique mix of performing credits, academic experience, and connection with the wider community through my foundation. And I think why this is so hard for me to come up with, because I've never separated them. I never thought of them as three separate entities, the things that I was doing. So as I was trying to figure out how do I discuss and try to separate the three, instead of finding differences, what I found is really more similarities between all three. And the similarity was that they're all about music and the passion that I have for music. I've just always taken whatever opportunities arise, I take it and do with it what I can. I've never thought about it as something different, that it's all been related, and I'm grateful for the opportunities that I've been given. I'm going to use the stool in between. Still hooked up from the hospital this morning to go there right after this. And excuse me. If I pass out, then you can be worried. If I'm a little dizzy, don't worry. I'll come out of it. But as I was thinking about, like I said, these three things that I do, playing full-time with the symphony, teaching full-time at SMU with the Trumpet Studio and head of the Winds and Brass Division, what's become now a full-time charity foundation with Cancer Glows. And then, of course, the teenagers, if anybody has that, you know, that's really the full-time job. And putting it on top of it, and people always ask, you know, well, how do you do it? And I think when it's something that you're so passionate about, you don't even realize. You don't even think about it. It's just something that you do. You get up every morning, and you're actually grateful for what we get to do. When we all came into this business, because at some point it changed our life, and music meant something to us, and we wanted to go into it. And I see a lot of students in here, and that's why you're here as well, because you want to be able to have this career. And so when I was thinking about it, I thought, you know, what's the power of music? And I looked up one of the definitions that I really like in music. It says vocal or instrumental sounds combined in such a way as to produce beauty of form, harmony, and expression of emotion. Then when you look up passion, one of the definitions I love said strong and barely controllable emotion. So we see a definite connection between these two, between passion and music. And it's the emotion. That's the one thing that sort of makes us human beings different from everything else, that we can feel these emotions, and we can live them, and we can experience them. And then one of some of the best ways that we found out to do that is through music. And I've always believed that. I think that's why I've sort of been involved in it my whole life, but certainly the last few years, I've been able to experience it in a whole different way, and I'm going to be getting into that. But to start, and one of the things I've realized is the importance of music, and I've been told that if you take a group of archaeologists and you ask them three things that have been consistent in every civilization that we have discovered, no matter what timeline, any type of civilization that has been discovered, there are three tools that have been found consistently. And that is tools for worship, whatever that might be for that civilization at the time. Tools to provide food, whether that's hunting or grinding up a food, but something to eat to nourish the body. And the third is tools to make music. That those three tools can be found in every civilization. And if you think about it, then you realize how important music is to us and to society and to the future. It's something that we can't live without, if you look at it that way. I mean, we need to fuel our mind, our body, and our soul, and music is one of those. whether it be hitting a stick on a hollow log or making a drum out of a skinhead, you know, or something, but music was being used, music and dance. The art was always part of human society. And I remember when hearing about that, thinking, wow, this isn't been an elective in school. This isn't something extra. This isn't something that we can do without. This isn't something that a city should be able to say, should we have a symphony or not. It's known that we need it. We need the music. And as society and things change, and I know a lot of the students here, and I remember being a student and being panicked when people come by and say, oh, it's different now. We don't have as many symphony orchestras and full-time jobs. We don't have full-time studios going on in LA and New York anymore. There's no jobs anymore. I don't know what you're going to do. You know, you start panicking. But when you think about it, that if it's a necessity in our culture and in our community and our lives, there will always be music and there will always be opportunities and there will always be an available place and a time for us to be able to use our art. And there will always be an appreciation for it. I just think through time it changes. And sometimes we have to be a little more creative to be able to figure out how that might work and where we might fit in. It might not be the traditional way that it's been that we saw with our teachers and our teachers' teachers. But it's certainly something that the community needs. It's a heartbeat that humans that we need. We need music. I remember my teacher, my mentor, David Zauder. I played second trumpet in the Cleveland Orchestra for almost 40 years. And he used to say that all music can be divided into two categories, song or dance. Meaning that if it's a song, it's literally, it's got words, it's telling a story, it's trying to put us in a different place than just sitting in our chair right now. We need to picture ourselves in a story, or sometimes maybe it's just depicting a meadow or another place, but it's to transport us and make us feel alive with emotions, for us to hear what's being said. And then the other one's dance. And it's the one that you don't even realize when you start tapping your foot. You know, it just happens. It's just something that that we do. When I'm talking to students, I always tell them, you know, there's the tune in the radio that you turn it up, you make everybody be quiet because of the words. You know, oh, I love these words. You know, they think they're so great because they make you feel something's written just for me. And then there's the other the things that you turn up in the car, and then all of a sudden you're driving fast. Even know how that happened. But either way, the music had a way of controlling you. It's making you feel alive. It's making you do something without you even realizing it. And that was his idea. So when I was playing music, he'd always have to say, well, which one are you doing? Which way are you trying to move the audience? How are you trying to make them feel alive? Are you telling a story to make them feel that? Or are you trying, or is it a dance? And so when you look at it also that way, you realize the, you know, how important that music is, and that, you know, we don't have a choice to enjoy it and to love it. It's there, and you start realizing that it's everywhere. I loved the one year in the early 90s. I know the students are probably thinking, early 90s, how old are you? but I was teaching in the music appreciation class, and I was trying to explain to them, and suddenly, the first thing I was trying to make them explain is just how much music is everywhere. They don't even realize it. In the background of things that they're watching, or in the commercials, and constantly on the radio, it's always around us, and it is always affecting us, whether we realize it or not, whether we're musicians or not, it's playing a role. And it was so great to be able to try to enlighten them, make them realize that same thing, if they're driving, what type of music, how is it affecting them when they're sitting there and they're listening? And emotions are contagious, you know, and so to be able to have the power of music to be able to control that with those around us is quite something, and it's also a huge responsibility that we have as musicians and educators. I was originally thinking, you know, this was a lecture, there's no way I'm going to talk for an hour, nobody wants to hear me or anybody talk for an hour, so I thought, well, I better play some things, and then I read, oh, it's a lecture recital. Oh, then I better play something. And then I just realized a couple minutes ago, welcome to the recital. So you got to find more music to play. But I wanted to play a few things that I find are some of my most favorite and passionate music that I've been able to play in various venues around the country. And so this next one, we'll go ahead and play the, let's do the Kirsch one. I think that's up. It's Someone to Watch Over Me. And it's, as far as I'm concerned, Gershwin's one of the greatest songwriters. I know at some point he was considered, you know, purely a jazz composer, but you can't find a symphony hall anywhere in the world these days. It's not playing some of his music and orchestral music, and he certainly crossed over to in the classical zone now as well. We're going to do a beautiful arrangement of Someone to Watch Over Me.
Thank you.
One of the other things that I love about music, and certainly working with students as well as my colleagues, is the fact that I don't know a whole lot of other professions, groups that you can be a part of, that you consider it a team sport, although sometimes it's an individual sport. You can throw chamber music in there, large ensembles, solos, and even with solos, I still find it being a collaborative chamber music setting. It's the responsibility of, and accountability that every individual has, regardless of the ensemble situation, or whether you're in a classroom or on stage. It's the same thing that we have an obligation to be able to play our part, a single role with others, constantly. Rarely, or I don't think ever, even conductors, even though they'll argue, are above everybody on their own. We need to be able to work together, and it's a scenario that what makes it special is that it's for all personalities, all individuals, all walks of life, different experiences, personal desires. It really doesn't matter. It's one thing that's a common denominator that we can all be together. You know, you look across the orchestra, or look across the classroom, and you see the diversity, the differences of where everybody came from, and their own experiences and type of personalities and families. And we were just sitting there talking about where you're from. I mean, here we are. I would never have thought I'm going to spend today with someone from, you know, Czechoslovakia or Slovakia, and well, somehow now here in Tyler, Texas. I'm from San Diego, so who knew this is where we would meet? So, you know, it's such a unique industry to be able to be in and to be able to be a part of. And so, another thing I always think about is, I mean, then what does it take to be successful? If anybody can do it from any walks of life, any type of background, what's the difference? I mean, what makes one person more successful than the other? And to me, it's very simple, and it comes down to the passion for music. I know many people that are better musicians or better technical players, and they do make it for a while, but it's a lot shorter, their career, than I know others who truly have a passion. And they work hard, and then they actually are able to speak to the audience or speak to the students. And it's those that are going to be able to continue. It's those that I push forward when I have the opportunity to be able to bring somebody in. If I see an open door for a teacher or for a performer, I want the one that's going to be able to play music with me. I want the one who's going to be able to say something to the audience, who's going to be able to understand what I'm trying to say, not necessarily the person that might not ever miss a note, but it doesn't say anything. And so it comes down to the passion. And do you understand it? Do you live it? Do you believe in it? Is it part of you? So, you know, who is a performer? Every person is considered a performer. I was the weird one in my family, where my father was a high school band director. My brother was a high school band director. My uncle's a high school band director. My aunt was a high school band director. Grandfather was a community band director. My great aunt was a community band director. You get the idea. So somehow I'm told we're involved in music some way. I think it's five generations till we go back to Denmark's court musician. But I'm the first performer since that court musician to actually go into performing. Everyone else went into education or just heavily involved in community service with music. And so I was the weird one when I said, I want to play, like, you know, in front of people. And I remember my family thinking, you're crazy. And I would look at them in front of the high school students and think, you're crazy. I mean, I can't even imagine doing that. And then as I got older, going through school, I realized, you know, the true performers are the educators. because you have to perform every day. I just perform maybe once, you know, a couple times a week with the orchestra, and I get to sit in the back, and every once in a while I get to do a solo thing. But you, every day, are in front. And whether you realize it or not, you are performing. The students are staring at you. They're taking your guidance as far as what are you saying of the importance of it. Is this really a class I need to take, or is this something that I'm going to use later on, or is this something that I want to be able to use later on? It comes from the instructor. It comes from the teacher. I'd love to say it comes from the individual teacher, but you know, I'm the last one who works with the students as far as to be able to keep them excited. It's in the classes where it starts earlier, and even in high school, to get their passion going, to get them excited about, you see them every day. I see the students once a week. So it's not all on me. It's on their instructors that they see every day. It's on the students that they're around and how their students are responding to their teachers. Like I said earlier, I mean, emotions are contagious. I try to teach this when the students are playing. We've all been in a room where some people are laughing in the corner, and next thing you know, you're kind of chuckling. You don't even know what's funny, but it's funny. There's something going on that's amusing, and suddenly you're in a good mood. And there's also been the days when I've been in a good mood, and someone comes in, and man, they're bummed out. Next thing you know, it's a drag in the room, you know, and they've brought you down. These emotions are contagious. We can't help it. It's part of our human nature. So when we're in front of an audience, or you're in front of your class, what are the emotions that you're wanting the students to feel? And I always have to remind myself too, for doing the Gershwin or the Haydn or something that I've done a lot. I was playing for Leonard B. Smith, he was a famous band director for many years. And we were doing Stars and Stripes over July 4th concert for the 2000th time, playing Stars and Stripes as a trumpet player, and you know, you're just kind of going through the motions. And he stopped and just chewed us out. And I mean, you know, we didn't miss a note. I mean, we know the piece by heart. And he was so mad at us of how we were just relaxed and playing it and not giving it the energy and caring about it. And he said, you know, everyone out there has heard it 100 times, except for there might be one kid. This is the first time he's ever heard Stars and Stripes. And this has to be the time that changes his life, that every time he hears Stars and Stripes, he's never going to forget this moment out sitting on the lawn July 4th hearing it. And it's our responsibility to be able to play Stars and Stripes, you know, at the best ever, and to be able to change his life, that he remembers this march, and every time he hears it forever, he'll remember, you know. And he started, you know, getting honest, and I thought, well, he kind of has a point. You know, I can't really argue that. For someone that's the first time they get to hear what you're talking about music. And it might be the course that I've, you know, I've talked about every semester, and I go over and over, but each semester it's new kids the first time. And so I remember, you know, a lot of times when I'm teaching, I try to show the end result, get them excited. Oh, I want to know how to do that. Great. Open up Armin's book, page one. And if I do that to start with, they're like, oh, man, I don't want to do this. Oh, I don't want to learn how to, you know. And that's my teacher in high school was that way. He wanted to teach me on a triple tongue. It's like, oh, man, I don't want to sit. I'm from San Diego. The sun's out. My friends are out playing. I want to sit here and, you know, learn how to play. And I love to play cornet solos. And he gave me one called The Maid of the Mist. And it has bum, 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 but it was like, oh, man, I want to learn how to do that. And so that's, you know, he got me excited about it so I could learn how to play a song. And then I was like, oh, well, that's the case. Then, yeah, I'll practice it. So it was a matter of trying to find out, how do we make something that's, you know, to us might be routine, but exciting to the students because it's the first time. It's the first time they've heard about, you know, that part of music that's your responsibility to be able to give to them. So just as it is for me to take seriously Stars and Stripes when I'm playing at that Parks concert. And there's always one person out there. You know, and what's amazing as well is you don't know when that's going to happen. There was several years ago, I was diagnosed, I think a lot of people know, with an incurable, what they were calling at the time, terminal cancer. I'm we say it's treatable. Because I was given 2 to 3 years and like just passing six and a half years. So we keep that going, but it's a constant battle against it. I've had 3 stem cell bone marrow transplants, 2 in the last 6 months. And January came back again. And so there's lots of times when and I kind of wonder what's the purpose, and then how do I get through this? And every time the doctor says, you know, we're done with this med, we're out of this medication, we're going to try something else. And when people ask me, you know, what's been going on, I mean, there's only a few constants that have been the same in the last 6 years. I can't say it's my schedule. I can't say it's my diet. I can't say it's my medications. But I can certainly say it's my music, my faith, and my family. Those are there. And again, it goes back to those 3 things that are that the archaeologists have always found. And it was a few years ago when we were doing Mahler 9, and I thought, I just can't play my job anymore. I was having difficulties with some pain in my face and some of the medications I was on. I remember thinking, I have to quit. I have to retire. I can't do my job. And I had a meeting with the maestro, with Jaap van Zweden, told him about it. And he said, well, just go out there, just do your best. That's the only thing you can do to fight this. Can't just sit in the seat, go and do your best. Okay. I go and I play. It was a horrible night, for at least for me and my standards. And I go home that night, tell my wife, it's just, can't do it. It's not worth it to me to be able to do something that I can't do at my best. I get an email the next day from a lady from Oklahoma, and her father was diagnosed with multiple myeloma. He was older, didn't want to do the treatments, didn't want to do the bone marrow transplant. So they said, well, let's just get away. They're music lovers, and we'll just go down to Dallas for a weekend, just get out of the place, just, and we'll go to the Symphony to do a Mahler 9. It'll be great. They're in the balcony, halfway through Mahler 9, she points out to her father, see that trumpet player down there? He has multiple myeloma. He had a stem cell transplant. He's playing Mahler 9. They get home, halfway home, he looks over to his wife and his daughter and said, I want to call the doctor Monday morning first thing and schedule for a bone marrow transplant. So she emailed me to thank me that what I did that night playing, she said, perhaps you just saved my father's life and gave him more years in our life. This is the same night that I was going to quit. So you just don't know. You don't know really the power of music. And the only thing that Jaap told me is just go out there and play. And I used every passion I had to try to get anything I could. And somehow, the night that I thought I was going to quit changed this family's life and certainly this gentleman's. So it was another reminder that it doesn't matter even sometimes what we even think is the level of excellence if the passion and the right meaning is behind it to the individuals who are listening. So what we are talking about, whether it's being a class or what we are showing, what we're conducting, what we are performing, has such a deep level that I think even we as the performers and the musicians don't even realize all the time. And it's not just to the musicians. I think we get so comfortable within the four walls of the school, and we get comfortable in our routine, and then suddenly when we get a chance to play for those who are outside of the security of the school and of our jobs, that's when the magic happens. That's when we get a chance to take what we've been learning here, and that's when we get a chance, whether it's talking to somebody at a social gathering, sharing our passion about music, or whether it's sitting on a stage, it doesn't matter. It's a chance that we get to affect others, and we get to affect the community around us, and it comes from our passion and our belief of that what we're doing is that important. So we started this foundation called Cancer Blows. We do these concerts, and originally it was just to do one in Dallas to fundraise money in 2015. And actually, the way it started was from when I got diagnosed and the type of subset that I had. They gave me a few years, and I was touched lot of my musical friends from around the country reached out to give me good wishes, and one of them was a performer, Doc Severinsen, which I know a lot of the students are thinking, you know, who is that? Google him, YouTube him, the rest of us, we certainly know that name. And he called the week before my transplant to give me, tell me good luck, and that he was thinking about me, and I was touched by that. And he said, I wish there was something I can do. And I said, well, Doc, actually, now that you brought it up, I said, just promise me that we can share the stage again. When I get through all this, and which I will, I'm going to, you know, go through this thing, and I'm going to beat it, and just promise me we can share the stage again. And he said, well, of course. You know, and so that became my battle cry for everybody who called. I wish there was something I could do, anything I can do. Promise me we can share the stage again someday when we get through this. Oh, okay, great, you got it. So I just thought everybody's being nice and polite. You know, it's a good thing sort of dangle in front of me. So on the bad days, I'm thinking, okay, I got to get through this so I can share the stage again with all these people. And I remember lying there in the bed one time thinking, man, wouldn't it be amazing if they actually all did it like at the same time? That's impossible. There's no way that would actually work with everybody's schedule. And I remember my wife laughing. She goes, oh, yeah, we'll do a concert. And we'll call it Cancer Blows. You know, and we laughed. And that's how it started. And it was a couple days later, I thought, man, that's actually a really cool name. This is a good idea. We should try that. So after I got better, literally, then I remember Doc calling again, saying, all right, when are we getting together? I said, well, I don't know. And everybody started asking that. The concert really came not from me, but from these other musicians who were serious when they told me that. I thought they were just being nice. They were, you know, that's all I would have done. they were serious about it, and so we did this concert in 2015, and we had 25 of perhaps some of the greatest names of trumpet players that came out. I mean, Doc Severinsen was there, and Arturo Sandoval, and Alan Vizzuti, and the list goes on. Lee Loughnane from the band Chicago came off tour the second time only he ever left the band. The first time was for his daughter's birth. The second time was to come play for Cancer Blows concert. And we had the principals, trumpets from, I think it was Cleveland, Chicago, New York, Boston, Philly, all came out. It was quite the to-do. And I thought, okay, great. And then afterwards, everybody said, when are we doing it again? So next thing you know, and the audience people said, oh, yeah, when's your next one? And it slowly became, not because we wanted it, but because of the demand and the wishes from the community, we became a full-time, year-round charity. And now we do concerts around the country, some smaller ones, and also some bigger ones. We're working on one in L.A. We had another one in Dallas a couple of years ago, and we did one in San Antonio. And so we've raised over $2 million so far, and we give 100% of all our proceeds to cancer research. And as someone had asked my wife before, like, well, why do you give everything away? You know, don't you want to keep some, you know, salary? And she said, well, I'd much rather have my husband around than to have some extra money. And so that's all volunteer group, and that's what we do. Anyways, this isn't a commercial for that. It's not even in my notes. I didn't even mean to do that. It's just, I guess, I it's habit. I get in the, you know, just talking about it. But the idea is, what I didn't realize with this foundation, we started it so that we can fundraise and make money. What I learned in the past few years, though, is that the most important thing about the foundation and Cancer Blows is how it's affecting those people, how it's affecting the patients, the caregivers. That I was surprised with. The messages, like the one I just told you about from Oklahoma, the other messages that I get when they say, thank you, we got your CD and the DVD, and I've been playing it for my friend who's got cancer, and they said this was a huge help. They listen to song for hope every night. When you hear things like that, you realize really the power and how important it is. And that's what I didn't understand necessarily about as much from music. You know, because I started as a child, that's just what we did in the family. So when I was seven, I was like, here's a trumpet, and my dad gave me my first lesson, and my lessons for the first few years in the living room, because they needed a trumpet player to go caroling to play the third trumpet part, you know, and so that's just what we did. Up an instrument and play it. And so I never, you know, thought of it as anything but just fun and intriguing. And it wasn't until becoming an adult that I realized it was a lifeline, you know, and necessity for the quality of life that I need right now. So I'm reminded through that, through the foundation. And that's been the biggest thing, is to realize how much it changes lives. And everybody here, if you haven't experienced that, you will. And when you do that, then you realize what we're doing and how important it is. So I'd like to play again. We'll do Gabriel's oboe. This is something that I played on the first Cancer Rose concert, and I play it ever since, everywhere I go. So I'll do it for you now. Was the importance that we've talked about music as far as quality of life and the emotions and how it can give us hope and strength. But on the actual real technical term, as far as how important music is to to us. We've been hearing a lot about there's the music and the brain and how there's a correlation with all of that. And there's a group that I've been involved in. I wish I had more time to get more involved in them, but I just can't. But they've been finding out how music, we know about music therapy, we know about all of that and how that helps patients in their recovery. But this was different of how it was being used, and I find it very enlightening. There was a clarinetist in Cleveland, graduated from Case Western Reserve University in education, and she had just graduated, I think a couple of years behind me, got her job teaching at an elementary school. Everything was going great. She was on her way to the school early in the school year and was hit by a semi-truck who ran a red light and went into her car. When the ambulance and everybody came, they didn't even check on her because they knew she was immediately deceased, and just worked on the truck driver and those, and then it wasn't until later they realized that she was alive. She was in a coma for quite some time. While she was in a coma, they were able to repair her body as much as they could, and she did come out of the coma all right, except she had complete amnesia. And so they thought, well, she's a musician, we'll put her in music therapy. And so she was in music therapy and doing the drum circle and doing the things that so many do. And her old teacher walked in and saw her and actually got upset. She doesn't play drums, she plays clarinet. You know, why does she have two sticks in her hand? You need to put a clarinet in her hand. And the music therapist said, well, are you willing to do it? He said, sure. So he went to have a lesson with her, and she didn't even know how to put the clarinet together or which end or what the reed was or how to form an embouchure or anything. I mean, completely loss of memory. So he started working with her, and of course he had all the same books and knew where her books were, and he was the teacher for years, and so it had all the markings and everything that they had worked on through all these years. The doctors also said in about 5 years they hope that she can go back to teaching and doing, you know, work full time. She was back within 2 years, and she did the Mozart clarinet concerto about 7 months later. And as he was teaching her, reintroducing her to the clarinet, every time there was new scales, every time there was something new, she started having more memory, other things coming back. And so they thought, well, this is really fascinating. And because what they started to realize was, you're not, instead of teaching somebody something new, teaching them how to play drums, teaching them something new, they realized there's muscle memory in the brain that we've already done all this, so how do we reach that? So as she was learning new things, it was triggering the muscle memory, and every time it did it, it opened up a pathway, and when it brought that out, it brought out other elements and other things. So they started doing this with head trauma, and then it moved to stroke victims, and then they said, well, why don't we do it with cancer patients with chemo brain, which I used to think was a made-up word, and I'm here to tell you there's some truth to that. At least I'm sticking to it, that's my excuse. And so they started, and they called me, and they said, are you interested? I said, sure. And they said, well, how long did it take, you know, for you to play? I said, well, you know, I play all the time. I said, you play every day? I said, yeah, I play every day. Did you play, did you do that after your transplant? And, well, yeah. Did you do that while you're on chemo? I got on chemo, I play every day. And they said, well, how are you with your treatments? I said, well, this was years ago. And I said, I'm about 6 months ahead of schedule of what they thought I'd be, and I'm doing this and doing that, and I was performing after 2 months, and they said, usually around 6 months, somebody goes to work part-time. And they said, well, what did you do? I said, well, you know, I just started back at the beginning and just did some easy stuff, and before realizing I was doing the exact protocol of what they're trying to do. And since then, I've had a few other friends that went through transplants, and I told them, why don't you do me a favor? Take your instrument. So I got a picture of a tuba player with a practice mute all hooked up right after transplant, you know, the week after, sitting there in the hospital. I'm sure that people loved that. And then also another trumpet player who did it, and they were all released early, and they were all ahead of schedule and all doing better than what they thought. Now, is this just a coincidence, and that's what we're trying to do? I mean, how do we compare exactly someone, you know, who didn't to do this or not? It's impossible, but the idea is for someone who has been involved in music, we're giving them this muscle memory that is actually now saving their life, literally. And so when you look at it this way, music in the schools is not an elective. It's actually one of the most important things we can give them that could theoretically save their life later on. So it's a question of how long do you have to play in order to get muscle memory to be able to know what's happening. I've never gone to the hospital and they, when you check, do you have this, do you have this? Oh, did you play in band? That's not a questionnaire. Do you play an instrument? And my father, who now conducts the San Diego Community Concert Band, and I went there and I looked at him, and of course, you know, half of the band were retirees that got their instruments out, and I looked at him and said, well, half of these are going to have a heart attack or a stroke probably within 6 months, and you know, this instrument could very well be exactly what's going to save their life. Now, how do we get the school districts and administration to understand that? I'm not sure, but the fact is that I'm a firm believer in that, and I think all of us here are that is of importance, that what we're giving these students is more than just something for fun. And whether they're going to go into music for the rest of their life or not, music will be part of their life forever. And what does that mean? And where is that going to go? And where is that going to take them? And I'm just amazed now when I hear that story and hear her talk and realize that now her playing clarinet literally saved her life. And talking to these other patients and myself, people ask, well, how are you beating this so well? I mean, it could be because I'm stubborn. I mean, I don't know. But is it because I play trumpet? I don't know. You know, they're always testing for my lung capacity, you know, if I'm sick and, you know, breathe in this tube, make sure I have pneumonia. That's my favorite part. But I don't tell them. You know, so, it's always interesting. And, you know, just kind of look at me and, oh, by the way, trumpet player. But there is something to this. There is something that is really important, that what we're doing is, I think, on so many levels, more important than what many give the credit for, those who aren't in music. I want to invite my colleague up here right now, Jeremy, to join me. I want to thank Kyle for asking me to come and do this, Jeremy for playing, and Elena Dottery, something like that, I'm sure I butchered it, for playing. A lot of this was last minute. I certainly want to thank all of you, not so much for coming here today, because you're at the convention, I probably had to, but thank you for coming to the convention, because obviously that shows your interest and your passion in what we're doing. And I can only play so much for whoever's in the audience, but all of you get to affect classrooms and hundreds of people all the time. And that's truly where it lies, where the future and where music and the power and the passion comes from. And so I thank you for that. I thank you for continuing and allowing music to thrive. And if it wasn't without you and your interest in coming to things like this and continuing it and realizing it and making everybody realize how important it is, our world and our communities would be very different. So I thank you for that. And like I said, it doesn't matter whether you're on stage or in the classroom. It's about the passion of music. And so thank you very much. I enjoyed my time, and we're gonna play a little bit here. In my haste before going to the hospital, I brought the wrong part, the wrong trumpet, and no mutes. So I'm borrowing and reading everything, but this is come on up and get ready. I want somebody to be prepared. It's a piece called Showdown that Jeremy found, and it's thanks. While you're at lunch, we did the premiere. It went great. It was fantastic. So that we would do it again.
you're here.
Usually I make the joke, thanks for being here, if you weren't just be a rehearsal, but this is a rehearsal and you are here. So, no, this is a wonderful tune. It was written, ironically, for Ronnie Rahm and his son. Ronnie Rahm was a famed, I can't say was, still is, a trumpet soloist. He made his claim to fame in Canadian brass for almost 30 years. He was sort of the name and the face of Canadian brass. He was the bald guy with the beard and the sound. I mean, I remember as a kid, I mean, poster of Ronnie Rahm and Linky. Yeah, so I had, you know, Canadian brass and up there. And in 2000, perhaps one of the greatest things of my life outside of events with my family was getting a call asking if I would fill in his shoes, literally, with the Canadian brass. I say literally because we had to get new shoes the following week. They gave me his shoes. It was like that week we had to show up and they wear these crazy shoes. And then we were on tour, so I was like, you know, and he has much bigger feet than his clown shoes. But I had a chance then, and we've been friends since, so it's kind of fun to play this a piece that was dedicated to him. So without further ado, here's Showdown at the Hoedown. Thank you very much. Micah, you got your horn? I mean, if you want to come up here, just in case, you know, you play my part, right?